Everybody, welcome to the Midweek Podcast presented by Yoshimura Racing. I'm Don Maeda, and I'm here with my long-time friend, Jay Clark. I think, 1990.
Now, it wasn't that early. It would have been 93.
Are you sure?
Yeah, because okay. I didn't really get started. And you were at Cycle News.
Yeah.
Around 93, right in there.
Yeah, so I started Cycle News, and I remember you worked at Wiseco.
Yep.
And you sent me a press release and had some photos of some pistons, and you wrote, yeah, you can use these photos in Cycle News. It's cool. Ken Fott shot them. I'm really good friends with him, and I have his permission to use them. So that's what I remember you as, is the guy that sent the press release saying, I'm great friends with Ken Fott. You can use these photos.
Well, yeah, I had to, things were a lot different and more difficult then,
Yeah.
Actually physically mailing press releases out and getting people to run.
With slides.
With a slide photo, yeah. So, and it's just, but you took it for granted. It wasn't any big deal. That's just how you did things.
Yeah.
Well before social media and all that.
Absolutely. Okay. So over 3 decades, we've known each other.
Yeah.
You've gone through many different roles in the industry. You've been Wiseco J.
Yeah.
Then you were Dunlop J or Hot Cams J.
Yeah.
Ranch Rabbit J. But now I just call you Dirt Bike TV.
There you right? go.
You've gone from being a rep or, someone that helps promote products. Yeah. And you still do that. But you've kind of become a YouTube sensation.
Yeah, and it was just meant to be a kind of an addition for the companies that I work for. So I work for all these companies, and they all it's a nice way to add additional promotion for them. When I do something with you, and then I can also show it, and then I want to promote all the media outlets that I work with too. So that's kind of was the thought. And then on the social media side of things with Instagram and stuff, it's turned out that there's a lot of people that they're not, we take for granted being around the industry. You go around the race team shops and you see all the stuff that people do. Well, you take it for granted that some basic mechanic type stuff, a lot of people aren't aware of how to do it. And so we show a lot of really basic stuff. And some people give me grief for showing really basic stuff. But that's some of our most popular things.
That's the timeless stuff that gets watched for years and years.
Just adjusting, brake levers, clutch cable, throttle cable, adjusting things that, you take for granted because you do it all the time. And then when you get a new bike that's a little different, you can figure it out pretty easy. So, but not everyone knows that, or just changing the oil, tips on that for different bikes. And so a lot of people in different areas also where we're at, we're spoiled with all these, all the shops and race teams. So in some areas, guys don't have much of a network of other moto guys to go, to go look at how they're doing it. So that's just very small network they have. So that's been really helpful, I think, for what I do, is people see a lot of that, and it's been really cool.
Yeah. Okay. So let's go back to the start. All right. Mm-hmm. I knew you as Wiseco J from the start. You just were a remote employee for that company.
Yeah. So I actually worked for Wiseco and I pitched them on the idea. They were back in Ohio, and they had a small warehouse up in Santa Paula by Ventura. And one of the guys, the guy that was running the place, I talked to him. I go, hey, they need somebody out here representing them. I was trying to think of how to create a job. And so it took me like a year of hounding, like in 92 or so, I started hounding the company in Ohio. Mm-hmm. And just some great people. Bob Anderson's was one of the key people there. And Bob Gorman, who owns Cometic. These guys were just great people and a really good family. And it took me like a year of talking to them. And then I finally got to meet them out. They came out here. One of them came out here for vacation, met them. And then they flew me back to Ohio and then hit it off. And I worked for them for like 12 years straight. And we did, I'd go to all the nationals and supercrosses, help with the teams and get banners up at the track. And they call me Sticker J or Banner J, because I'd always be really aggressive
on banners.
And I worked hard at it, and we did a good job. And then, unfortunately, the company got sold, and with what I've been doing, the only reason I've changed companies, I've never wanted to change companies, is just because of people getting bought and sold. And so the company got sold, there were some changes, so it was better for me to go off with Kurt Leverton, a really good guy in Iowa who owned Hot Rods. And then he ended up buying, he owns Pivot Works and Hot Cams, and he ended up buying all these companies, worked for him for 15 plus years or whatever it was, right? And then he sold. And then got by, I don't want to say, you know, big evil company, whatever.
Right? Okay.
So they all get, and that ends up happening, unfortunately. And there's not, I don't say there's nothing wrong with, but for the most part, most of these companies kind of lose their soul a lot, you know. And you know what happened to White Brothers, and it's happened at some of the other companies, and it takes a while for them to right the ship. Eventually, they do when they realize, hey, we got to have some people that know the sport.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, it's like this sport was built on enthusiasts, and they think, and a lot of times I've learned that they think that those people like Tom White and maybe even Donnie Emler or Mitch, they think these guys got lucky, you know,
it's a deep rooted passion for
right.
your subject matter, right? It's the same thing as me, like, right. So I started Cycle News and then I went to Dirt Rider.
And then you started MX Racer?
MX Racer.
I was going to go through it for you.
Yeah. But the whole thing is like, then when I got to Transworld, I was like, okay, this is my chance to build something from the ground up.
Right. It's just
so
yours.
I made sure every employee I hired ever was a dirt bike rider.
Right.
Like, because you have a passion for the subject matter or the industry you're working, the product is better. It's genuine, right?
Yeah.
So that's why we're all in the dirt bike industry. It's like none of us are going to try to get rich.
Right. And that's
working on dirt bikes.
And I get that question a lot. And one of the things that those big companies don't understand is that feeling, Kurt Leverton, we talk about this a lot, is that feeling on a Friday night when your part doesn't show up or you get the wrong part shipped to you, and you'd be willing to drive 5 hours to get the right part so you could ride on the weekend, right?
Yeah.
There's people that in these big companies now, they don't understand that feeling at all. Mm-hmm. They don't get that what you've done now to a customer who now he lost. You go, oh, he just lost. He couldn't ride that weekend. He couldn't race. He couldn't ride that weekend, whatever it was.
There's always another race. Always. That's what they think, right?
You know what? And there's, when you have that passion in you, you're bummed when you miss out on a ride day or a race day or a whole ride trip because of getting the wrong part or whatever problems. And so he understood that. And that's, and so now when I left, I went back to the Wiseco group, and there's some good people. And one of the good things that's happened at that group, this race winning brands that has Wiseco Pro X, JE Recluse, they have some really good companies, but they have a lot of enthusiasts still involved highly in the company. And that's what's really nice. So, you know, that I think it takes some of these companies a while to figure that out, that we got to get these enthusiasts back in these key roles. And you have those enthusiasts there. And that's what's been helpful with the Wiseco group. And of course, Dunlop still has tons of enthusiasts all throughout it. So that's been nice. So I've had the 18, 19 years with Dunlop. Yeah. And that's been good, where I help them on the media side, as you know, with helping with, like, you know, with you guys and other media outlets. And then all the bikes we build, of course, are all Dunlop.
Yeah. It's kind of funny because you've essentially managed to make a living, a nice career out of fun.
Yes.
Kind of like myself, right?
Right.
But it's like I've never woken up on a Monday and gone, oh, gotta work.
And that's way too. And I don't want to diminish that. It is a lot of work.
Yeah.
But it's way better than digging ditches. So whenever I complain, that's what I always say. Like, it's better than a real job. And there's many times where I'm up, you know, till midnight, or I'm on the computer doing stuff. And especially if I go riding a little bit more, like that week's a little bit busier with riding, then I'm, you know, I know you do too. And you're paying the price doing stuff late at night, getting up early and doing stuff. So, but that's some of the advantages we have. And for me, I've worked from home for over 30 years. So that's been really cool.
It's funny because, so at Transworld, right? Like, obviously we had the burden of a magazine every month. So I'd bust my ass for like 10 days and get all the magazine work done and then have a lot of fun,
right?
You know, but then, you know, the website developed and stuff, but then it still was manageable. Right.
Right.
But, I never realized how stressed I was. Like, you know, I just said I was never regretting work Mondays. But towards the end, our last owner, like, we had these Monday manager meetings, right?
Right.
And I didn't realize it until I was free of that job.
Yeah.
Sunday, about 3:00, I would start getting stressed out. Like, what is my boss going to tell me I have to cut back on now?
Right.
Or what extra ridiculous project to generate revenue is going to be putting her off in my lap, right?
Right.
Like, we had everything from selling these stupid notebooks for children in Brazil with dirt bike photos on the cover, or skateboarding. Like, all of us had to,
oh,
like,
oh my gosh.
There were so many things to try to manage the decline in print media revenue.
Right.
That they're trying to force us into doing. It was like, it was really discouraging and stressful.
And I think, and what I'm amazed at now is how much content you guys put out here. So, like, I look at the number of videos you guys put out. But
it's because I don't have to do a magazine every month.
Right. So you guys are able to do, you guys do so many things, you know, it's just like, there's something, you guys have at least one, if not 3 to 4 things going up a day. It's crazy. So it's,
I almost like you're the YouTube expert, right? Like, I almost think we need to create a second YouTube channel so that we're not putting up multiple things on one channel per day. I don't know.
It's tough because, and YouTube's gotten a lot tougher as far as that algorithm and different things. But at the end of the day, you guys are building your own followers. They're going to want to see, you know, Monday, and they're going to follow their segments that they want to see every week.
Yeah. So then it was Dunlop for however many years now too. Mm-hmm. It's funny because Wiseco J, that name stuck with you even when you were not at Wiseco, right?
I got so frustrated, and then I would just go, okay, fine. And it took years. And then finally, as it kind of started to wear off a little bit, then I went back. And it's been great to be able to go back. And there's still a few key people there at Wiseco in Ohio, which is really cool. Still some of those people there. And then, of course, a lot of new ones. And so that's been really cool.
Can you talk about, I guess, the evolution of Wiseco? Because back in the day, Wiseco's reputation, I think, was not that great. Like back when I was at Cycle News, right?
Yeah, so I think
they're known mostly for like big bore pistons.
Right, and so because they would have pistons for big bores, which now when you make a piston for a big bore, one of the problems is there's tons of other variables that can go wrong, not just the piston, because the power valve's got to be cut away from there. It's, mm-hmm. it's a larger, it's not intended to be that way, right? And then you have the engine builder that's setting it up, and if it all gets set up correctly. So a lot of times there could be problems that weren't necessarily the piston's fault, but the piston's what's going to take the abuse and what's going to look like, oh, that's what happened. It, you know, mm-hmm. caused a problem. Then as far as pistons go, the technology and the, you know, throughout, when I got there, so throughout the 90s, the mid to late 90s, we had, you know, we started with Kawasaki, with Yamaha, with IMIG, and then Kawasaki with LaRocco and IMIG and all those guys all running. We worked with Rick Ash and Butler and different. So we had a lot of really good teams running two-stroke pistons. And the key was just making sure they were set up at the proper, you know, clearance. You know, that would be a big thing. So throughout then, it was really cool to be able to have a lot of those top teams and then trickle over and see the success that it brought. But I think through the air-cooled times, you know, getting into that was tough. You know, with a forged piston and an air-cooled cylinder can be a little tougher, and you need a little bit additional clearances. But a forged piston is stronger, and most all the race teams that were racing at the height of two-strokes, they were all running a forged piston, whether it was from Wiseco or from Japan back in the day.
Yeah. Man, like myself, you've seen the sport change, right? Like all two-stroke to four-stroke. And I mean, how has that affected your job?
It's interesting. Well, first I'll talk about personal. I will say back in 02, 03, 04 in there, I was saying, I'm going to buy 3 or 4 CR250s and leave them in the crate. Like I was seriously, yeah. I said it. Like I'm like, I'm never gonna ride a four stroke. Yeah. Like I was set on not riding.
It was like me. I'm never going digital.
Right? So I was never gonna ride a four stroke. And then once I started riding one, I rode an 04 CRF250. Started getting a little bit better. They had some bog issues. We started working on, and I worked with Tom Morgan. He got that carburetor better. I was like, man, this thing's easier to ride. And my lap times were better. I remember comparing. It was like, because on a YZ400 at the time, you know, and then the CR450 that, you know, it was just too much. And I wasn't, and they were heavy.
See, I thought the YZ400 was sweet.
Yeah.
Right? But when they went YZ426 and it got really hard hitting.
Yeah.
I crashed that thing so much. I hated the 426. Yeah.
For me, the big ones were just too much and too heavy. So then I rode 250s and felt pretty good. And then I would modify and make big boards. And that was fun for stories, because then we figured out with 250 four strokes, guys like that size of bike, but then if they can make a big bore one, that was cool. So, and with carbureted bikes back then, as you know, that was the whole key. They were tough to start. You remember seeing the Geico team back there, you know, 4 guys push starting a bike before, because the cams, if they modified the cams, it would be difficult for the auto decomp to start. So you can remember the guys not making a main start because of the kickstart, you know. And so we've seen that shift into EFI, which has been awesome. I mean, it's like, who doesn't like a fuel injected bike? And you got that 300 SX out there. That's like, that's a really cool bike.
Yeah.
And I think for guys that now I'm seeing, if we had stayed on developing two strokes, like, and had that 15, 20 years ago, and we had not really rode four strokes, but went from our YZ250s to that, I think it would have been cool. Yeah. But now it's too much for me. You know, that's a lot of bike, but it's pretty cool. I think a guy that really likes two strokes, is really good rider, can ride those well, is going to be competitive with the 450s, like at a vet race, no problem. I think. Have you guys spent much time on it yet?
We got it. And Rene Garcia, our test rider, he wrote a bunch, fell in love with it. To be honest, I haven't taken it out yet.
Yeah.
Like, although we may be heading to the hills tomorrow or the next day, and I think that that's the bike of choice.
Okay. Hopefully I can go with you. We'll see where we're going. So
we're going up north, you know, the unspeakable place.
Okay.
But,
all right.
So when the world went four stroke, like, you're obviously a very skilled mechanic. Did you have to learn new things? Because, I mean, you know, two stroke in and out.
Oh, like, yeah. So the first time I did a four stroke top end, I just used the book. I had the YZ 426 or whatever book there, and I just followed it, you know. And and back then, there really wasn't much. There was no videos, you know, in 02. We weren't watching YouTube.
You know?
So we weren't looking up videos on.
You had the climber manuals.
Yeah. So, and we'd just be following the manual. Put it at top dead center, follow it. So it did help me learn a lot. And then the last few years, last 10 or 15 years, I have a good buddy, Brad, who does most of my motors. I just have him do them, and he's really good at it and better than me. So that's been helpful. Mm-hmm. So that keeps me time to do some of the basic, you know, stay busy with all my other stuff and putting engines in the chassis, getting them going and changing tires and all that kind of stuff.
Talk about your role at Dunlop then. So you obviously media service is part of it. But then I'll see you at the pro races, helping out sometimes.
Yeah, I don't do too much. They have a good crew at the pro race. I will help. Brian runs the pro, you know, teams and as far as fitment goes. And I'll help them out, like, you know, before the Supercrosses or before the Nationals. I'll go out with – he comes out the week before, help out at those. So I don't have to help out too much at the actual races. So they have a good crew that does that, really good crew. And so mainly help out with the media stuff. And then all my bikes that we build are all Dunlop. And then just all the social, and we do a tire change video. It seems like every, you know, two or three a week.
I was gonna say, like on your YouTube channel, for instance, how many tire change videos are in there?
There's like 30 or something. And on Instagram, there's like over, you know, there's hundreds.
Yeah.
So I
know what's still so weird to me is that, like, your method is still something I can't wrap my head around. I still do it the other way.
So that's how Brian, that's how all the Dunlop guys do it. It's pretty much how I do them. And I try to do it that way because I figured when I started, Brian came over, I go, hey, we're going to start. I need to do it the way you're doing it. And that's how I just practiced over and over. And
did you not do it that way prior?
No.
And so you did like me where you pushed it off.
Yeah.
Okay.
And now so, it's so much better doing it the way we do them.
Okay. So what we're talking about is Jay breaks the bead, brings it over the rim, flips it over, does the same on the other side.
Right, and leaves the tube in. Then,
yeah. You know what's funny is we never actually did our little race, right?
Yeah.
But like I used to be good at changing tires because when I started riding and racing moto in the 80s, there was like, do you remember that period in our sport in Southern California where there was no legal place to ride?
Yeah.
You could only race
right
at the tracks, right? So I would ride with my brother out in Mockingbird Canyon or
so you change your Van tire.
Buren. So I would race Ascot Friday night on a new tire. Take it off, put a beater tire on for Sunday.
Right.
And then like Wednesday, take it off, put the new tire back on until that tire became my beater tire. So I became pretty good at changing tires. Right. Like funny thinking back to when I first started doing it with screwdrivers, you know?
Right.
But I developed a technique that was pretty good. But like I could do a rear tire in under 10 minutes.
That's great.
You know? But since I broke both of my naviculars, like I have a hard time with the push down.
Oh, yeah.
Right? So for me, I can't do it that quick anymore.
Yeah.
But my technique's way different than yours. I sit on a bike stand and I use a Home Depot 5-gallon bucket and I change it and I squeeze the tire between my knees and all that.
Oh my gosh.
But you know, I can't do it on a stand like you.
What we'll do, we'll come in here, we'll have to do a side by side.
So they have cameras. I'm slow now because my wrist
is working. I did do a video, which is really cool. If anybody wants to look, we have a video, which is helpful for beginners. I did it blindfolded.
Oh my God.
So yeah. I did a full tire.
I'm sure. Yeah.
Yeah. I did a rear tire and it was an 18 inch tire and it was a MX12, like a directional tire. So then I can feel the direction. I did the entire thing completely blindfolded and I did it in like 12 or 13 minutes or something. Yeah. And that's talking and showing it. And I had all my tools over here. It was kind of fun.
Yeah. Do you remember Marissa that worked at the pro shop at Milestone?
Gnarly. Yeah.
Like we shot a pinup with her.
Yeah.
Beautiful girl, little, probably 100 pound girl, could change a tire like that.
It would just show its technique, not strength. Because obviously I'm not very strong, and you don't have to be. And small girl, and she was able to do it. It was pretty cool.
Yeah, I always wanted to do a how to change a tire video with her, but it just never came together. It would have been good. But okay, talk tires then, right? Mm-hmm. So, man, one thing, it's kind of amazing to think that Bridgestone doesn't have presence.
It's been a long time now, yeah. Right?
Like, remember Doug Shapinski, like, at every race? And I think he's with Pirelli or something now. Or
I'm not even positive, sure, but he's...
But, okay, so Dunlop. Remember when Bridgestone went away and everyone had to go Dunlop? Remember what a big deal Chad Reed made about Dunlops and hating the Dunlops and everything? Like, what was the hard thing for them to get used to? Because I know Bridgestones are softer sidewall, so they... compliant.
And more of that's on the pro side of things. And they would have some spec tires and some of the spec tires from Bridgestone. And most of it would come down to whoops and how that tire handled through the whoops. That was a big thing, you know, and what the pro riders like through there that most of us would never be able to feel.
Yeah.
That you know, that what's going to keep them stable and still going forward without losing grip. So that's a big thing. I think, and within a couple years there, everything was pretty cool. I mean, they've far exceeded, I think, what everybody was hoping for with all the teams. And now we have basically everybody running Dunlop. You know, they sweep every weekend, as you know. And
yeah.
So it's pretty cool. And it's nice to see additional development coming on. Like last summer, the big news was MX-14. Mm-hmm. And everybody talked about that because that's a tire that I like. I like, because I run MX-12, and I ride at Glen Helen and Cahuilla mainly, or the hill tracks. And I run it pretty much year-round. And people go, what about afternoon? And I don't ride in the afternoon.
Yeah. Yeah, you go to any track and Jay's already there burning laps by the time you get there.
Yeah.
And he's gone before you finish your first moto.
Yeah. So in and out early, and then people go, why is that? Why? Who goes wakeboarding or, you know, skiing in the afternoon when it's all choppy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's my logic, is I want to go when it's kind of smooth. And I'm still, you know, still riding Glen Helen. Glen Helen, when it's smooth, is still a tough track.
And Glen Helen in the morning with the MX-14, there's nothing better.
It's so cool. Right? And so we'll have the MX-34 coming in the future this summer, I think. And so
what
that'll
is
be,
that then?
That'll replace MX-33. So as our main.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, as the main intermediate tire. So that'll be a big news. So hopefully we'll see when that's coming. That'll be a big news coming on.
Does 14 work good at Cahuilla?
It works great. Cahuilla's not ripped as deep as it used to be, but still plenty good early in the day for sure.
Yeah.
Still soft enough.
It's funny the amount of interest and hype that the 14 generated.
It was
like,
crazy.
Like, I've got a good friend. You know Louise, the little Korean girl that hangs out with me? Her dad has just been like, how do I get a hold of one of these tires? How do I get one? So that's when I got one from you to give it to him. And yeah, he put it on and couldn't wait. And then didn't take it off, and he went to some hard pack track up north and was like, dude.
And that's what I was telling you. With the key with those is, and unlike your Ascot days in the 80s, it's nowadays you can buy a wheel pretty reasonable. So I tell guys, man, get an extra wheel if you can afford it. Get an extra wheel with a, you know, sprocket rotor and everything. So you can just, you can even bring your 33 wheel, for instance, and have the 14 set up for the practice and first moto.
Yeah, that's what I do at Glen Helen.
Yeah, and that's the key. And then you can run that 33 for the second moto. And there was many motos where Tomac didn't even bother switching, you know, for second moto. When you, they would making a big deal about it in the race. They're like, oh, we're not sure if he's... And he would just keep it on because he was used to it. And that's what he's even running in Colorado when he was practicing. So that was pretty cool.
Okay, there was a point in your life when you were a marathon runner, right? Talk about that a little bit.
Well, I've always been, I always loved jogging, and was never very fast, but jogging, I always loved jogging. And then I tore my ACL first, and Dr. Baum fixed that. And then like 8-10 months later, when I got back on the bike, I tore my Achilles really quick.
Yeah, I remember the Achilles.
Oh, and that was a killer. So I tore my Achilles, and having surgeries, as you know, sucks. And so... So within a year after the Achilles, I started being able to jog again. And then I go, man, I should just really get into this. And it was nice. And then I got to where I did, in 03, I think it was. So now we're 20 years. I did a marathon and did it 3:40, which is really cool in Utah. And then, I did a couple, probably 3 half marathons and that's been really cool. But since then I just keep having little injuries, and they're mainly foot related, which means it's really difficult to stay running. And then of course, keeping the weight off makes it tougher too, without being
mountain bike.
Yeah, I know. And it's like, I can't get into it. And I know this guy's, it's changed his life dramatically. And I see the people that,
can't you get into it?
There's just various reasons, but the biggest problem I have is that time of, especially because it's difficult right from my house. So I'd have to load up and go. And if it's like, if I'm going to load up and go, then I want to ride a motorcycle. That's my problem. It's like mental. It's like, I want to go, then I might as well just go ride my dual sport or, you know, my trail bike or go to the track. And I'm busy. That's another problem is I'm busy. And so with jogging, it was nice because I just got up.
Run out your driveway.
Just run out of the driveway. You get it done. You do 40 minutes.
You don't live that far from Greer Ranch.
I know. It's right there.
And we just discovered this other place to ride in Menifee too.
The one over by the crosses?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's popular. I've been up there. And my buddies, and I know guys who built a lot of those little, those jumps and stuff. And the other problem I have when I'm on a mountain bike and I head to a jump face is I twist right here.
Takes a little while to get used to.
Oh my God.
And it's hard to trust the tire that's 2 inches wide.
Oh yeah. You know? So I just kind of think the ship has sailed even, and then everybody's like at the e-bike thing. And the problem with the e-bike thing is then I need to be out twice as long to get that much of a workout, you know? Yeah. It's like, and so I'm also paranoid of getting hurt doing something other than riding moto. I want to get hurt just doing moto. I don't want to get hurt, but if I get hurt, I want it to be on a bike.
See, that it's funny because it's changed for me, right? So like, I started riding mountain bikes 8 years ago, mostly to improve my health because my doctor said I was going to have to take all these pills. But then I was like, oh, this would be good training for moto, right?
Right.
Well, now I can ride moto as long as I really want to. Like, I could probably ride one of your motos with you.
Yep.
But when I'm riding my motocross bike now, I go, dude, it's way too much exposure to potential crashes and injury, and I won't be able to ride my bicycle.
Wow.
So I pull off the dirt bike.
Yeah, we was talking about my long motos. I like Glen Helen. I like to do 40 to 50 minute motos typically. That's what
So when you're doing these motos, are you trying as hard as you can the whole time? Or are you pacing?
No, it'll go throughout the moto. It'll change a little bit, especially if I see somebody or somebody passes me and I go, I think I could stay with that guy, you know, and I'll stay with him for a while, you know, and then I'm picking it up. Obviously, if he passed me, then it gives me something to look at. So, you know, maybe part of it, you know, you're riding it 85-90%, and then there's parts where you're riding it 100%, you know, and maybe for 10 minutes straight. And then that guy pulls off. Okay. Then you're cruising and maybe you're going a little slower, you know, and shaking out the arm pump a little bit. And, you know, but to me, it's really fun to be able to do those long motos. It's nice to do it while you can.
Yeah. Okay, how did you evolve into this dirt bike TV thing? Like, obviously, Instagram's something we all kind of mess with, and it's a pastime. And I remember when you first opened your Instagram account, you used to go, dude, it was when I was really into playing practical joke posts on Charles Dow. You're all, dude, like, you got to mellow out that stuff, because me and my kids look at it, you know? Like, I remember I had one with a doctor, like, looking in someone else's butt or something, and I said, this is Charles Dow doing this and that. But I mean, all of a sudden you have this gigantic account. Did you make a conscious decision like, hey, I'm going to be this social media powerhouse? No. Or did it just kind of organic?
Yeah, it just started to grow. And Spencer, my son, helped a lot with, he's like, I think, because once it started to roll a little bit, he's like, this can get going. When we first started it, we even lost our first account, signed it. My buddy helped me with his kid, dirt.bike.tv, lost that. We'd posted 10 posts and I'm like, no one cares about this. This is stupid, whatever. Right. And, we lost the sign-ins for that. That thing's still out there. So we made a new one and then started posting more regularly. And I saw that, I think a lot of companies would value what social media could do. And of course, that's happened a lot, that companies value that. And I'm sure you guys even use that as part of your guys' whole campaign for companies you work with. You know, you're going to promote them when you talk about anything else. And that's become a big thing. And I think that showing your value socially is going to be a big deal. I'm surprised. You know what? I don't follow NASCAR much, but when I saw a post from a guy, a NASCAR racer who's a pretty top guy, I looked at his following; it was pretty low. I'm like, and that's where it's nice to see, you know, people like the Deegans and Travis, you know, getting in when they're in NASCAR. NASCAR's realizing the value of bringing some of those type of people into their sport. So there's just a really big value there, and there's no way around it right now. So I don't keep much personal on there. It's all just shop and bike related. So that's been good. And my son and daughter and my wife all help with different aspects of, everybody kind of helps with that and does certain, you know, certain things, but I do most of it, I guess, but they help with a lot of that. And then Spencer helps a lot with the editing and video stuff. So that's a really big help. And we do reply to everybody. We try to get everybody to email us. And so every DM and everything, we answer everybody. And if it's difficult, they say, hey, email us. Because I can type way better than I can with my thumbs answer a DM. Phone. And then the problem, if you start DMing and they're asking you all these 20 questions, what happens, we've also created this really cool thing. When they email us, I send them back this Google Doc that has all these different topics of things we've answered.
Oh,
it's crazy. So it's a huge Google Doc that has, answers to tons of things that other people have asked similar questions. And so that'll help them get going with the different links that we have.
So the whole premise of Jay's channels is how to.
Right.
Like how to do this on your bike, how to make this better, how to perform this task efficiently and easily, right? And you're really good at it. It's funny because we've used you to help with some of our how-to videos. And you just like, you already know, line up the tools you need and there's never any second take. You just spit it out. Obviously you're comfortable at it or you're comfortable and familiar with it.
Yeah.
It's funny because like YouTube is such a resource, right? Like for how to do anything.
Yeah.
I think the first time I really realized that is we had Thanksgiving at my house, like however many years, a decade ago.
Right.
And my wife cooked the turkey. And my cousin used to always come over with her electric knife and cut the turkey, and she wasn't there that year.
So
and my wife's like, oh, you're going to have to cook the turkey. And I'm like, I don't know how to do that. So like, I literally went on YouTube and wrote how to carve a turkey.
Right.
And I had it propped up against this candle, and I'm like pushing play and pause and everything. But it's like, well, you can learn anything on YouTube.
It's what
like
we do.
I've learned how to do pretty much everything on, I mean, and the funny thing is the things that are on there, right?
Yeah.
Like sometimes I'll get sucked into the YouTube black hole.
Yeah.
And like, there's some guy that made some video like how to wash the inside of your windshield more effectively, right?
That one's really good.
Millions of views. I'm like, what the heck, you know, but.
They use a soft squeegee.
Yeah.
Yeah. I got one.
but you really found a niche there, right? Like how to do different things. So have these companies that you work for seen value in your channel and utilizing them in your videos and stuff?
Yeah.
And has that helped you negotiate your compensation for greater than just representation with the media?
Yeah, I think so. And it just helped me keep me relevant, I guess. I think if I hadn't have done this, I'd be kind of, I'd gone the way of like the print media side thing of things where it's, you know, you can't just stay. If I had stayed and refused to do the social media and not built YouTube, I think I probably wouldn't have. I'd probably be doing something in the industry, but not as much as I'm able to do now, because you have to keep yourself relative and show a value there. And so I think that's been helpful to be able to do. So in some ways, I'm providing more, but I still have a good job, you know. Mm-hmm. So that part's nice. So it's good to work with good companies and that value what you do.
Yeah, you know what's funny is when Transworld was purchased and we got let go, I was a good friend, Chad Smart, that runs a sheet metal business in Corona Baghouse. And he told me, Donnie, go buy this book, Who Moved My Cheese?
Yeah, I've read that, yeah.
So it's this book, and it's analogies, right? These two mice and everything. It's like, but the premise of the book is you can never be complacent and satisfied with your success. You have to always stay abreast of the trends and the changing times. And it's funny because, so I read that. I was like, reading about some mice. But then it sunk in. I'm like, okay. But even in the last 3.5 years we've been doing Swapmoto Live, things have changed again, right?
Yeah.
It's like magazines don't matter anymore. I mean, I'm sorry, Mark Tilly. I love you. You're my buddy. But magazines don't matter. And it's almost to the point where websites don't matter as much. It's all YouTube and social media. It's crazy. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, and I remember talking to you right after you left Transworld and, you know, wishing you the best. And I was surprised that you didn't have anything set up. And it took a little bit for you to figure out what was going to happen with this. And I thought it was pretty cool that you're able to land on your feet and make this happen with all the good dudes that you have. So it's been really cool. But I remember right after, and I thought for sure you had something, and there wasn't.
Dude, I mean, to say the rug was pulled out from under me was understatement, right? Like, I mean, we're the number one motocross magazine in the world. We're the number one magazine in the company, you know? I had been bought 5 times previous, and nothing ever changed. I wasn't even going to go to the town hall meeting, you know, to meet the new boss. And my boss was like, you better come by it. And I'm like, oh, something's going on, you know? But like, I literally didn't know what I was going to do.
Well, and that gives a good example with how successful that magazine was. If that magazine was at Racer X or, you know, the Coombs family or with High Torque, those are privately owned companies, you would have been fine because you guys were, but these big companies expect way more, you know, bang for their buck or whatever, right? They're just expecting more, and which is a bit unfortunate because it's like, it's obviously fine for the magazines that are there. And now they all have to maintain sites and social and YouTube as well now. Mm-hmm. But, you know, that's, you would have been fine at, if you were privately owned, you know.
Yeah.
You know, it's the same thing happened with Dirt Rider, with Peterson and with all them.
Yeah, it's crazy. It's crazy to think how much everything has changed, right?
Right.
I don't know. But, okay, so another thing that you are big in is, like, building these project bikes. Mm-hmm. Not only for magazines and stuff to test, but, like, what do? Go on. I know it was probably the recycler early on.
Yeah.
But you have this knack for buying pieces of junk bikes, right?
When you fix them up. You're trying to get them cheap. But so I do two things. I work with a lot of like current 23 bikes because mm-hmm. I like to ride new bikes. And yeah. So with the luxury of, I just bought a 23 350 XCF for me. Kind of my favorite bike because mm-hmm. it does everything well. And then a lot of times I can get a loaner bike to use for different motocross things, build it, use it for 6 months, and then give it back. And mm-hmm. that's been really nice. I work with shops or the OEMs, and to be able to do those kind of things is really cool. So working with new bikes is probably my favorite. And then the older bikes are cool but take way more. Like I could do 3 or 4 new bikes mm-hmm. to one old bike build, you know, easy, you know.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work. We just shot that KX125 and Brent did most of the work on that, but I did a lot to help finish it up. And it's just way more work when you finish up these old bikes, when you powder coat the frame, you take everything down. And then when you have 20-year-old, 25-year-old suspension, I'm building these three bikes right now with, I'm building 395 CR250s at one time, three. Mm-hmm. I have three engines done, three frames done, everything. Okay, I have three sets of suspension done that Race Tech did. It took me 7 sets of suspension to make 3.
Oh, because the parts are scarce.
Yeah, and so if something's broken inside or the two worn out, and of 2 of those sets, we had to hard anodize because the insides were worn out, as you know. Mm-hmm. So it takes a lot of parts in these older bikes it's not as easy as a lot of people think. And a lot of these parts are becoming really scarce on, mm-hmm. you think that a 95 or up to even a 05, 95 to 05, you think, oh, there's going to be plenty of parts available. There's not.
Yeah.
You need an air boot or whatever, or, you know, anything to do with an air box. Even transmission gears, all this stuff's not available anymore. So, and it's going to get worse and worse because now more people are starting to do it. Since COVID, people have started to want to fix up bikes. And mm-hmm. people, even that don't even live in California, that aren't building them for a media outlet, they're building them for themselves and posting on their own social. And we've worked with some really good guys. I got a good buddy, Michael Fisher in Nebraska, built some bikes with him. And, of course, Brent Griffiths in Vegas. So we work with some of these other guys, and it's been nice to be able to see what other people do. They mm-hmm. can do it all there. When you build these, you got to be careful that you get them cheap enough. You want to get them cheap because it might be a total loss, you know.
You know, what's kind of funny is, like, as a kid, well, like, I'm sure you have one, right? There's always one bike you wanted but never got, right?
Yeah.
Like, for me, it was the 1986 Kawasaki Takati 250 three-wheeler, right?
Those were cool.
Because I started on three-wheelers.
Right.
The 83, 84, 85 all had the radiator located on the handlebars.
Okay.
Right?
And then it went down moto style.
And then in 86, maybe I had the years wrong, but it went moto style, right?
Yeah.
And that was so sick. But at that time, quads came out, and my dad was all, this is lame.
Right.
And so I quit, right? But I've always wanted that Takati. And when eBay was still popular, I remember I found one on eBay, and I was bidding for it. And like I had the money, and I was like, okay. And I was watching it in the last like 2 minutes going down, and I was had my finger on the refresh to see. It's like, and I could have won that thing, right? Totally could have won it. And right at the last second, I'm like, wait a sec. What am I going to do with this thing?
Right.
I'm not going to ride it. And where am I going to put it? And it takes up 3 times as much room as a dirt bike.
Right.
So then I didn't. And then the guy lost it. But, it's funny to think, like, I still want it. Like, there's a brand new one at Kawasaki, and I was there the other day with John Rawl, and I was like, can I see the Takati? And I sat on it, and I was like, oh, yeah, I would have fun with this. But, like, was there a bike like that in your life? And then have you bought it and restored it and sold it?
I haven't really done any that I dreamed of, but like I like the early the blue Suzukis, you know, like 89 RM250s. Those looked cool in there. And so part of me is not too held up on the exact nostalgic. I had a 78 RM80 as a kid. I probably wouldn't mind fixing one of those up. But then I'm so not attached to them bikes, you know, that I probably would build it and then just end up selling it. Because, like, I know when we built you that RM250, you were thinking you were going to keep it, and then you rode it.
Yeah, dude.
Okay.
That was a story itself, right?
Yeah, because that bike had been stolen, got back, and then you go ride it afterwards, and you're like, I'm not
going to. I mean, we built that thing.
Yeah.
And it was mint. It was, because it wasn't in bad shape, because it had, like, gotten blown up or something, right?
Yeah.
So we built this RM250. It was the sickest looking thing ever.
Yeah.
Like powder coated frame, and Bill's ported a cylinder, cone pipe. And I raced at the 2-stroke nationals. And I was sitting there after the race and I was looking at it and I'm all, man, I almost died like 10 times. Not that I did, but it's like the aggression you have to race a 2-stroke with is so much higher.
It's tough.
And I was like, I don't know.
And that's where I think
and that was a bike I owned, right?
Yeah.
That's like the last bike I've owned personally.
Right.
And I put it on my Instagram story and I wrote, anyone want to buy this? Dude, Brent Griffiths, within 5 minutes required. Is this available, sir? I want it. Well, no way. So that's how I met him.
Right.
And became a good friend with him. But
And that's really cool. And I think that's what's tough about the bikes nowadays, is that they're so good, it's hard to ride something that's not as good. Mm-hmm. And if you're used to riding, you know, a brand new KX450 that's got fuel injection and great suspension, you're like, man, this is so nice, and good brakes that stop, you're like, this it's hard to go ride something that's worse. And that's why I think that new generation KTM 300 SX, and also they have a 250 SX that a lot of people are telling me, I haven't ridden that one yet, that's a lot better feeling, you know, not as scary on the track. So I think that generation bike might be a little more friendly for us to try.
Yeah. So who is your current client list right now?
I work with a bunch of great companies, but of course the RWB group, that Wiseco Pro X, JE and Recluse, that group, Dunlop, FMF, like Ricky Bobby, we have our FMF shirt on here. FMF's been great, and it's nice to work with great companies like that. Kometic, I've been with a long time, and they bought Klotz recently. Oil, Kometic, Works Connection, Uni, I know you guys use a lot. Onyx Off-Road, great company, and Cardo Systems. They make talking through the trail riding stuff we do a lot of, especially in the summer. Mm-hmm. We've worked in some of those kind of companies, which has been really cool.
Hey, that was Cardo.
Mm-hmm.
They do a licensed KTM version or something. There's somebody on Instagram that keeps DMing me, you want to test this KTM Cardo Systems? Mm. And I'm like, well, I don't want to test the KTM one. Like, I'm like, if I was going to test one, I'd test the all-encompassing one.
They're really cool. I don't know how well it would, if there'd be some applications for a mountain bike or not, but it's really cool because, you wear AirPods when you ride bicycle or nothing? You don't do nothing.
I don't want to. Like, I get pissed when you see those guys with the Bluetooth speaker.
Right.
It's like, yo, I'm in nature. Enjoying outside.
Yeah.
Why do I want to listen to your shitty music?
You know? It's blasting. Yeah, that's probably not too cool. I agree with that. Yeah, we hear get that enough, like on the lake and stuff in the summer.
Yeah. So that's it as far as we represent.
Yeah. I'm sure I forgot somebody. I'm sorry if I did.
So your lubricants is
ODI bars.
Okay.
ODI bars. Worst connection, and ODI's been great. And I love the lock-on grips, man. It's like it's changed my life. It took me a long time to switch. And then once I started getting into KTMs, I was like, these aren't so bad. You know, I always thought they were too thick.
Oh.
But compared to
great.
Oh.
Dude, the new Emig Pro
is
the best grip you can get.
Right.
Yeah.
So good.
Lubricant, so it's just Klotz?
Klotz. And then, they're the only lubricant company, but I just use regular oil on most of my stuff, you know. And then, but as far as 2-stroke oil, I use theirs and the contact cleaner and things like that.
Do they still make the octane booster?
Yeah, they still do. And some, what do you call it? Kozak was the one we'd additive. We'd use at Mammoth. But now VP's up there with good fuel. That's oxygenated four up there. You know, it's really good.
So back in the day in the 80s, right? You know, when I was able to drive, I'd go to the bike shop and just like look for things to buy. I bought Klotz octane booster.
Yeah.
And I put it in my gas without telling anyone, like just thinking it's going to make my bike so much faster. and I had a Kawasaki Takati, you know, the green tank, turned my tank brown. So my brother used to call it Klotz tank browner, right? I'm sure they've changed it over the years.
I don't know. I think this stuff's tough on, you'd on want plastic. To put it on a black tank. I think you'd want to make sure you're
in it. And I just remember, I was like, oh. And then I had to order this seat racing tank cover.
To cover it up. Like cover the,
you know, it was funny. I remember, connected on with like elastic.
Velcro. Yeah.
No, elastic snaps underneath the tank.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. It's a long way. So yeah, work with some, it's awesome to work with good companies that are around for a long time, and it's cool. And it helps me keep doing what I'm doing. And then on the social side of things, it's really cool because we deal with people from all across the world. You know, mm-hmm. one of the simplest things we do that you and I post, I post it every day, is a tire stand. We have these tire stand drawings. So one mm-hmm. of our followers, because I showed a video on how to make one, and then one of the followers, a guy from Minnesota, he Jurgensen was his name, he drew the whole thing out perfectly. Mm-hmm. So we have the drawings that we can email you, and we get pictures. I probably send out 10 to 20 a day
emails. Really?
10 to 20 a day all through the world, and then I get probably, not everyone sends a picture when it's done, but I probably get at least one or two back a day.
Oh wow.
From people throughout the world with their pictures of their stand. And
any of them super deviated, janky?
Yeah, some have been janky, and some are kind of funny to show that they've built it off of they have like a tractor wheel as a base or something. They've modified things. Most of them try to do it pretty inexpensively and use scraps. And so mm-hmm. they'll use some scrap pieces that are kind of funny. And there's been some ones that are way better than what I have. Like guys are amazing machinists and welders that have made some really high quality ones. So, and then
that's not an easy task to take on, because you need to be able to weld.
Right. And so I always tell them, hey, if you got a buddy that welds or a brother-in-law, so everybody emails us on those. And that's been really a cool thing, because we got guys in every, I got an email from a guy in Russia and a guy in Ukraine, same day.
No way.
With picture of their stands built and then their bikes, you know? So we try to post these guys. So it's really neat to see throughout the world that people just want to ride dirt bikes. And it's cool to see all these different people emailing us on that stuff. So,
or you get an orange Home Depot bucket.
Right. Most of the emails I get asking for it are saying, I want to get off the bucket. They want to, they're like, can build one. So
no bucket life. Yeah. Okay. I'm going to hit you with some best of questions.
Yeah.
As a very seasoned mechanic guy, best tire iron.
Motion Pro. They're just the regular basic spoon, you know, the tire spoon, not the one with the handle. We'll use those if we're doing mousses, but just regular basic spoon.
That's weird that you say that, right? Because I've never wrapped my head around the spoon. Mm-hmm. Well, my toolbox was stolen a few years ago, so I lost it. But I had a tire iron I had bought when I worked at Pasadena Honda. Kowa was the name.
Yep,
K-O-W-A.
Yeah.
That one worked so great for me. And it was pointed, actually, rounded point.
Yeah.
But the new ones say show on it, but it's not the same show as the suspension, I assume.
No.
But.
And the spoon, it fits right over the lip, and it won't go in far like that one you had. That one you had could go in too far.
And with a pinch tube.
Yeah, so it's, you know, obviously you can still pinch a tube with a Motion Pro one, and it still happens. So it's the best just to be careful, and I like those the best.
Mm-hmm. Okay, best chain lube you've used.
So believe it or not, and there's a really good video online from a guy named Fort9 who has a huge following on YouTube. And I've known this for years. I don't use chain lube itself because it's too nasty, and I feel like it attracts more dirt. And it gets, especially out west here, where you get a lot of sand grit in there, that it really grinds in and it hurts the chain. So oil, to me, oil is the best chain. So we learned this whenever you'd have a blown countershaft seal, so mm-hmm. your countershaft's leaking oil, your chain was always lubed perfectly. Like, that was just right. And so oil, to me, the oil is the best. And there's a good video that I have a link to on our Google Doc and all that from this Fort9. He tested like 20 different lubes, from WD-40 to regular, all these different chain lubes and then oil. And he came up with the oil was the best one. And he did it very scientifically and tested fling off and tested all these different things. So it reiterated what I already knew. And I saw this a few years ago, like 4 or 5 years ago, he had it up. And then I'm like, yeah, we already knew that. So it's kind of
cool. So are you using like motor oil?
Yeah, just motor oil.
What weight?
Oh, like 85, like a gear oil. Uh-huh. And then at the track, we will just use like a WD-40 or any type of penetrating lube, like MPPL from Maxima. Their MPPL is really good as a lube. I just use that. And it doesn't make as much mess. My chains last just as long or longer, I feel like. And so that MPPL is a good one to use. And it way less cleanup. So try that.
Wow. That's crazy.
Yeah. And I just find it's way easier and better. And teams don't use chain lube, but they also don't care about how, you know, they're changing chains every weekend. But for regular guys, it's better. And then even with X-ring chains or O-ring chains, you don't want to have a chain lube on there, especially because it gets more dirt in there for those rubber O-rings.
Wow. Best bike ramp. Because I've seen you use a wood one.
I have a couple wood ones. I like the wood ones. I can't remember the company that sells the metal piece that you drill the holes in the wood. And I still have a couple of those. But believe it or not, I still have, and I have to give credit to Fly. I have two Fly ones that have to be 12 to 15 years old from when they first started making hard parts. And I have one in my van and one in my truck. And those things, they fold. But I've learned the trick is never to fold them because it's kind of dangerous, you know. So I always leave them long. And then because the way I drive, if I fold them, then when I get there, they're way up at the front. I have to jump in there and get it. So if I leave it long, I can pull it out. And so I've liked those. I don't like the ones with a lip on them because the lips are more dangerous, you know. Yeah, and I know you've had some issues with falls, half naked and stuff on bikes. So for me, that's the best one.
Are you talking about my bumper rack story? Yeah. No, that was no good. you know what my favorite ramp is made by DRC. In Japan, and Langston imports them. It's half plastic and half aluminum.
I think I've seen it. I think it's decent, and it's decently
wide. It's a folder, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that one's good.
Yeah.
Okay, what's been the best junk bike to buy and resell? Because I think you had a long string with CRF250Rs.
Yeah, over the years, what happened during the, so from like 09 to 11, in there when that housing crash in California, I was buying CRF 250Xs for really cheap. We would buy really clean ones from these construction guys or whoever didn't have money no more. And they were selling their toy hauler and everything. And we'd buy them from 900 to 1500 bucks, these bikes. Mm-hmm. And I had like seven of them. When they were 33, 133, 233. We had every number in there, right? And I had like seven of these things at one time. And then I end up selling them all. I did stories with them. We rode them. We beat on these things, and these were what Spencer and I trail rode with for a few years. And then I ended up selling them all for, you know, $4,000 to $5,000 when the economy picked up. So I did pretty good selling those things a few years. I kept them for 4 or 5 years and then would slowly sell them off. And now we all have better trail bikes, but those were really fun. And then any two stroke, especially 250 nowadays, if you can find a good, 95 to 05, 04, 250, you'll do fine if you can get it cheap enough to fix it and do a cleanup with it. But I tell guys, be careful how much because if you buy a bike for $2,000 or $3,000 as a core, it's going to take $3,000 to $5,000 to make it decent. So then you're like, oh, I could have just bought a YZ250. You know, so you got to be careful. You need to get this donor bike for under $1,500, preferably under $1,000 to start, what I tell people.
What about gas cans? What's been your best gas can?
You have that really cool metal one. I like that. But I mainly just use the VP jugs. They've been great.
I got a ticket leaving Milestone for having a VP can.
I can't believe that.
Yeah, no. Like, there was a cop waiting at the top, and he wrote like 4 or 5 tickets to people.
I can't believe that they would be. And I think times have changed since then. I think since things have laxed a bit with.
Well, no, because like you can't, like you go to an auto parts store, right? And the gas jugs that are approved have all that stupid.
It's terrible. You have to draw all that, take all that stuff out. But the VP jugs have been good, and they're not really approved for gas. You know, they're just jugs.
That's what I mean. They're utility cans.
Your utility can.
But the gas can, the metal one that you're talking about,
yeah,
you can buy it on Amazon, and it's a diesel can.
The thing's so cool. Yeah.
But actually, I've graduated to Risk Racing. They make this cool like can, but it comes with a tin thing that you actually screw into the base of your van. Like for me, I have it in my van.
Oh, and it stays there.
And it goes ka-dunk, and so there's no chance of it falling over.
I'll have to check that out.
Yeah, that one's pretty cool. All right, so you do these videos with people that come to your house to have a tire installed.
Right.
Who's been your best guest on that series?
Twitch.
Twitch, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Huge traffic with that, I'm sure, right?
Yeah. And what was nice about it, we kept it somewhat PG because he had his daughter with him, who was only like 15 or something at the time.
Yeah.
So that was nice.
Is he the most high-profile guy you've had come in?
Oh yeah, Jeremy's been over, and Imig, and you know, no current guys because we're mainly dealing with guys that are, you know, out of it, I guess. So Buttery comes over, good dudes. So it's fun.
Yeah. How did Buttery get on the program, the Jay Clark program?
I don't remember how it totally worked out.
He probably met you at our shootout or something.
Yeah, I don't remember how we initially did it. The first thing, the funny thing is I had no idea because when social was kind of, I wasn't that into it. We were at Paula and I was filming these guys goofing around in the pits. And I thought they were just like, this is stupid. Like, what are these guys doing? And then when I posted something, somebody says, that's Buttery. And I'm like, what's that? You know, I didn't even know what it was or who it was. And I find out. And then him and Eli, they're just really cool. And they're actually really nice and very respectful and really great. So they do have a fun time. And, you know, they do some crazy stuff. But they also are, you know, pretty good guys. So they're finding a good niche. And it's been cool.
It's funny that the thing I tell people is like, dude, Buttery is way more intelligent than you would expect him to be. Like from the persona he puts out, but yeah, he's a smart guy.
Yeah. And, you know, I think he's, you know, he's calculated at what he's doing and having, you know, having a good time. And, you know, you gotta be careful. Cause you know, Deegan got as big as he was for a few reasons, but also those injuries that you can, you know, we talk, you know, I think Brian even talks about that. That's kind of what helped build him and what built Militia and different things was, it wouldn't be half as gnarly and cool if you didn't have those cool scar videos and stuff that he didn't do it by, you know, choosing that, but that's how it worked out, you know? And so, there's a gnarly factor there. What it's pretty dangerous what a lot of the stuff they're doing is. And so as long as kids, if people are watching that kind of stuff or realizing, hey, it's kind of funny to laugh at, but you don't want to go try jumping, close to the freeway and jumping over fences and different things that, there's some consequences to pay for that stuff.
Okay, you did a video talking about all your chemicals one time, right?
Oh yeah.
So, what is the best non-traditional motocross chemical that you use to wash and maintain your bike?
Scrubbing bubbles. That's the one I get a lot because we can buy 4 cans at Costco. It's pretty cheap.
So it's an aerosol, right?
Yeah, and it's it foams up and it's really light. Not aggressive on the bikes as far as like staining. Some others, I don't mention names, but some of them can stain stuff, especially when it's hot. And in the summer, I find it's best to get your bike wet first. If you spray stuff right on it, sometimes that can be a little bit more aggressive on the, you know, especially anodized stuff like your hubs. That's a big common one. Guys write me, they stain their hubs with their cleaner. So scrubbing bubbles is a real...
So that's designed to spray inside the toilet bowl, right?
Right. So it has a small amount of bleach in it, I'm sure. A small amount, but it's pretty safe, comparatively speaking, you know. So we'll use that, and I usually power wash the bike, and then I'll spray scrubbing bubbles, and we'll scrub the seat and the frame, those kind of things with it.
So that works better than, like, Simple Green?
Yeah, and I think it smells better and less hassle, and it's being in that aerosol can is really nice. So I think it's just a little easier for myself, I think. And I think it's cheaper, but I haven't really compared. But I think the cans are like, you know, this is before COVID pricing, but it was like $10 or $12 for 4, you know, so it was pretty cheap. So, and I have 40 or so at the house, I bet. See, we had to buy a grip of them during the shortage. So,
well, like toilet paper, right?
Everything. It was crazy. So, yeah, we couldn't get scrubbing bubbles. We weren't gonna be able to wash bikes.
Okay. There's some specialty tools in motocross made for a specific task. What is the best specialty tool you have in your garage?
Oh, one of the coolest ones is the one that holds the sprocket stuff. It's very small. Like, the guy doesn't even have a website or anything, and they sell them through Rocky Mountain, but they make a front sprocket holder. The logo and everything is punched on. Like hand punched.
Like handmade.
They're handmade, dude. And they've cut them out of aluminum. And they've handmade these things, and it has 13 tooth, 14 tooth. You can adjust it by moving these pins, and that's just a really cool tool.
So that is to hold the sprocket while you're loosening it or tightening it?
Yeah, loosening or tightening it. So when you have your chain off, you can put your front sprocket on, and it'll hold it right there and goes around your swing arm, you know, guide. And it holds it there, and you can, and you're not tweaking no one's holding the rear brake, or you're not having to put pressure against your transmission. So you can, bike can be in neutral, and you're cranking that thing and get it tight. It's really cool.
Well, I would have bet money that you were going to say the Motion Pro Bead Buddy.
Right. That's very helpful.
That thing is a lifesaver.
It is a lifesaver. And that's very helpful. I was just, the sprocket holder's unique. Not a lot of people have them. And a lot of people just make do without them. And it's like $15. It's like, so it's cheap. It's not very expensive. And so that's kind of nice. It might be 20 or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I have a couple of them. And now I've bought and. They're nice.
That's funny that it's like hand punched on.
It is, and it's really old school. I think they've been around forever. I think they're made down in San Diego area somewhere, but I don't know for sure. But they're not really in distribution or anything, and so no one really knows about them.
Yeah, nice. Well, man, I think I'm out of questions. Is there anything you want to add?
No, it's been fun. Like, I think we covered everything. So
it's funny because you're like one of those behind the scenes guys, right? That everybody knows of you.
Yeah.
Like, oh, that's Jay. Jay, well, who does Jay work for? Well, he works for a lot of people.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's been fun getting to know you over the past 30 years.
Yeah, it's been awesome. And it's cool to see all the different places that we've all worked. And it's been cool to see that what this has grown into. And seeing the new place here is awesome. So it's cool that you got a new facility. So your third place in... And so hopefully you'll be able to stay here a while, I think. This should be a good fit.
Yeah, we signed a three-year lease.
Three years instead of two years. So this will be your longest for sure. So
yeah.
And hopefully this works because this is an awesome place. You got plenty of room for bikes and for shooting everything, and it'll be cool. So
okay, so dirtbiketv or youtube.com/dirtbiketv?
Yeah, dirtbiketv is YouTube, and then dirtbiketv1 is Instagram.
Yeah.
And then, and our website now is DirtBikeTV1.
So we have a website.
We changed it. Yeah, it used to be Jay Clark, and we didn't really do much with it, but we actually have a website up now. And that's
where you could put your tire change blueprints.
Yeah, it's easier just to have people email me because they get this whole like thing like that has all the links to everything like in one place.
Yeah. All right.
And then they get signed up for my newsletter too, which we haven't really done one yet, but we figure someday we're going to do a newsletter.
Right? Yeah. We have a big newsletter subscription list.
Yeah.
And like, I think Anton's written a couple, but I certainly haven't.
You guys haven't done one yet. It's a good way to connect with your people, but you guys are doing so much content, every week that I don't know how anybody's not aware of what you're doing. So,
yeah. All right. Well, Jay, thanks for coming on. You guys, thanks for listening or watching. The Midweek Podcast presented by Yoshimura. We'll see you next time.